Well, we've been on the surface and underworlds of Earth, but it's been a quick minute since we last ventured out into the cosmos and delved into what, if anything is out there, would absolutely destroy us. Halo and Dead Space shared the idea of a powerful hive mind taking control of people and harvesting their biomass in order to make themselves more powerful. However, the markers of Dead Space tended to lie dormant for longer and planned out a more usurping strategy versus the Flood, who just plain out body snatched anything nearby and won with sheer numbers. But what if there was a mysterious alien force out there that could very well predate most of these incarnations and use both of their means of conquering worlds so effectively that they actually go and hibernate intentionally between each harvesting session? Deep in the unknown abyss of dark space looms a maybe even greater threat to the universe at large. Advanced technology, a plethora of alien races and intelligence, and the unification of bitter factions could barely stand against the gargantuans that would cybernetically indoctrinate the masses and overthrow multitudes of civilizations, not just our own.
So this week, we are taking a look at the multicolored ending, These Are My Favorite Channels on the Citadel, the voice that does not match that face.
I'm Nakmor Kesh, superintendent of this station.
That is not what you thought it would sound like.
Handicapable Seth Green, we should have listened, getting in the middle of some calibrations. Tally wants some extra protection, putting a whole new meaning to a collector's edition. A Solarian spitting hotter bars than most of today's rappers.
I am the very model of a scientist Solarian. I've studied species Turian, Asari, and Batarian. I'm quite good at genetics as a subset of biology because I am an expert which I know is a tautology. My xenoscience studies range from urban to agrarian. I am the very model of a scientist Solarian.
I'm not a rapper.
The renegade that hasn't made, but the paragon has finally found me. Hopefully, this is more well put together than Andromeda, a Mass Effect with an ass erect game itself. This week, we are telling you why you wouldn't survive a Mass Effect Reaper invasion.
With humanity teetering back and forth on moving into full space exploration and entertaining the idea more and more of cultivating life and society on other planets, China grew cotton on the moon! Let's take a far reach and say either Elon Musk, Trump's Space Force, or NASA finally got a way to send colonies to the moon and eventually Mars. Colonizing the Red Frontier, whether it be months or years, settlers would have to eventually stumble upon ancient technology that would baffle humanity as a whole, discovering what would be known as a Prothean and data cache, causing humanity's most brilliant scientists to data mine the information, which would lead to the coordinates of a vastly large piece of alien technology in the far reaches of the Sol system in the Milky Way galaxy, specifically on Pluto's moon Charon. Humanity already went as far as Mars, and now there is a chance at finding what could be an ancient civilization's technology that could surpass our own. Countries across the world would race to Charon to unearth, or in this case, de-ice whatever it was, whether it be a weapon, power source, or something much more. This sudden expansion of what technology and other intelligent races that could exist would send shockwaves into Earth's entire political, economic, and religious spectrums. Whatever the ramifications of a typical human discovery amongst numerous foundations and countries, say a peaceful accord was made across all the countries across Earth, was made to go to Charon and discover that the moon of Pluto was actually a giant mass relay encased in ice, in which mass relays are gigantic, nearly indestructible transit devices all across the Milky Way galaxy that can instantaneously transport ships and vehicles across the galaxy to another mass relay in the matter of seconds, which in a normal instance would take normal spaceships years or even centuries to do normally. Apparently, the ancient race that would be labeled as the Protheans made it fairly easy for any relatively intelligent species to use. Humanity would be eager to discover what lies beyond the Sol system after generations of theories and hypotheses on the galaxy. The eagerness of mankind would lead them to triggering and activating all mass relays that they would come into contact with. It was within this point in the franchise lore that humanity first came into contact with the Turians. The Turian race was a part of the Citadel, a galactic coalition of unified governments across all alien species, which had forbade the use of certain mass relays. Turians, acting as the police force of the Citadel, saw this arrogant race breaking their established laws, as humans were none the wiser, and the Turians launched an attack known as the First Contact War. But at this point, however, this is where we will tangent from the original story of Mass Effect. Now, usually with with this series, I try to keep it within the limits of current human society and what we are capable of, right before we get suddenly attacked and get overwhelmed by the benevolent or destructive force. But in this case of the Reapers, it's more than likely that they would not engage the local cluster, which contains the Sol system in which our group of 8, or 9 if you count Pluto, planets are located. Reapers tend to attack civilizations that they evolved in line with the mass relays, as most civilizations will develop similarly once they have discovered the relays, all a part of the Reapers' plan. So in order for this scenario to occur, we would need to have explored space, and most importantly Mars enough to unearth the Prothean data, travel to the furthest reaches of our little solar system, and to break the ice of an established moon to further this reach. So let's go ahead and say if we propel our space exploration programs globally and achieve this within, say, half a century, 50 years or so. It's a stretch, I know. So what if humanity accessed these relays and upon using it to reach the Citadel, we're the first and only species to enter and inhabit the vast structure? So let's go ahead and bring in our special guest this time around, Roanoke Gaming, to discuss this. In which, before the Reapers even rear their calamari-like faces, they have something a little fiendish to undermine humanity before launching a full-scale attack.
Heading into indoctrination? So since I have quite a heavy background in the field of biology, you may be wondering how the effects of indoctrination even work. How is it possible for the Reapers to take a creature of any race and completely turn it against their own, leading to their species' destruction? This insidious process is much like water's effects on Earth, if you think about it. While water is simply nature, over time, even the mightiest structures have fallen to erosion. This comparison is drawn as there is one particular force used in the process that stands out the most, and that is electromagnetism. Electromagnetism has a love-hate relationship with the brains of people, but there are some particularly concerning effects that would make it quite easy to brainwash people into switching sides. The first effect that we need to discuss is the electromagnetism's effect on the DNA of specifically the neurons in the brain. Electromagnetism, or you know what, let's just call it EM because that's way easier. EM has the ability to shred specifically neurons' DNA. This can lead to the decimation of the cell entirely. This is an interesting outcome because it would not actually take high levels of EM exposure for this to happen. The real problem is exposure time. A creature exposed to low levels of EM for an extended period of time will have certain portions of their brain begin to wane in size as the cells in the area are killed. One of the things that should be noted about Sovereign is this is exactly what it puts off. EM levels are extremely low, however, so it would not be alarming to any creature that happens upon it. Instead, as stated in the game, it starts as whispers like something in your head. But now I can already hear you saying, then why not just leave? Well, there is another great answer for this. A lot of people attribute it to space magic or influence, but it's actually much more basic than that. Transcranial electromagnetic stimulation can alter your thoughts and even change what you believe in. Pretty creepy, right? The Sovereign ship clearly has the ability to produce this EM field. These stronger waves can be directed at any creature it is currently trying to indoctrinate, and then alter the cells of the brain to believe in something completely different. This is why Saren used to be a part of Team Turian and instead decided to play for Team Reaper later on. Even though he thought he was in control and he was helping, he was actually doing the bidding of the Reapers and doing great harm to any other species. His thoughts were forcibly changed due to these EM waves. It's clear to me that while he did believe what he did by artificial means, he still did have some reasoning though. In the final battle between Shepard and Saren, if you have a high enough Paragon, you can convince him otherwise. And seeing as Sovereign cannot influence him at that particular point in time, it's fairly clear that his mind has had its neurons scrambled to make him believe what he did. It is also known that EM waves have the ability to make you hallucinate. Affecting the occipital lobe of the brain as well as the temporal areas, this could have a major impact on an organism. Continuing with Saren, it is more than likely that he was legitimately hearing voices in his head whispering what he needed to do, but these voices were created by his own brain. On top of that, it is likely he was experiencing visual disturbances brought on by the firing of neurons in the occipital lobe. This would convince him quite easily that he was experiencing something that would for him be like godlike powers, seeing as he revered and feared the Reaper race. But what else can EM waves do? Why would a creature not panic and run away as soon as they found this thing? Odds are, when a species first encounters the Reapers do not attack outright as normally, instead letting the organic life exist around the Reaper, or in Saren's case, inside of the Reaper. In a relatively short amount of time, strong EM fields can be aimed at organics and outright passive. pacify their minds by producing a calming effect. So calm, in fact, that even if a Reaper were to begin attacking the species, it would not be able to effectively react to the attack, or for that matter, would even care. Strangely, in contrast, EM waves also have the ability to override your sense of self-assurance. If the same field is used on certain individuals, instead of calming, they will become panicked, disorientated, and filled with dread and fear. This will activate their fight or flight response, and due to the fear that they are feeling, they will flee. With half the population calmed into a state of not really caring and the other half running for their lives in all directions, an effective counter response would more than likely not be possible. This is how the Reapers could turn world leaders as well. Pacification, indoctrination, and control all can be completed with an EM field that the Reapers naturally produce.
The advent of heightened space exploration would be irresistible for world leaders and high-ranking government officials of all creeds to make the trip to the Citadel, as it would be the perfect centerpiece for a new hub of world leaders as they expand through the final frontier. Without there being other species like the Salarians, Turians, and Asari, total human control would be tasked with a new question. No longer was there the question, does intelligent life exist somewhere in the universe? But now the question was, where was the intelligent life in the universe? Leaving behind these advanced structures, and more so the robotic keepers, was proof enough, and with the ease on how to operate everything with somewhat easily decrypted instructions. Task forces would be placed to find more Prothean technology, travel to further planets for colonization, and search for extraterrestrial life. Let's just say before we could really extend human life to other planets while humans were buying or governing their way to the Citadel, one of the first planets that was discovered would hold a Reaper artifact that an excavation team returns to the Citadel with, thinking it had Prothean origins, but with a very different makeup and markings. With these artifacts on the Citadel, research teams and high-ranking personnel would be eager to see it for themselves. It would be at this stage that the effects of indoctrination would slowly set in. With the influence of the Reapers targeting key personnel that come into close contact with any Reaper-related tech, we would see the secretive initial onset of the Reaper invasion. Society and humanity as a majority, as a whole, look to governance, order, and pinnacle leaders to create foundation in everything they do. By seeping into the minds of these leaders in control of our governments and military or science structures of our species, the less chance that countermeasures could be in place for the future. Basically having unbeknownst sleeper cells for the Reapers, much like Saren for the Council, information on the Reapers would be covered up in every degree, even in cases where people were to be transformed into literal husks, or they themselves a total slave to their new master.
Heading into the late stage indoctrination. So now we are in the late stages of indoctrination. From here, creatures begin to form what are literal husks of their former selves. But internally, what has happened to these people? Where have their minds gone? How have their bodies changed? And what are those spikes that they seem to be speared upon? The husks are nothing more than a human who is 10% us and 90% cybernetic indoctrination. Their cells have, for the most part, been replaced by machinery as seen by the flexible pipes and blue coloring that they possess. But let's take a trip through the process. When a human is captured or simply led to a spike due to their pacified state, they are impaled through the back, more than likely directly through the spine. One of the reasons, as noted in the game, why this happens is that the shock of being stabbed through the spine would cause a massive release of adrenaline in the body as it essentially tries to flee the situation. And this is exactly what the Reapers want, as the adrenaline is actually a medium in which the nanites released from the spear begin to infect the body much quicker. So the higher the adrenaline, the faster the conversion process actually is. But ultimately, this more than likely ends the person, as there's no blood pumping. However, it is entirely possible that while the human is gone, the cells are still living, and judging by the fact that there are nanites confirmed, that means these cells are being kept alive, perhaps also by nanites, and then converted. These cells are also subjected to the EM fields that are put out by the spike, changing them as well. But what if the cells are dead already? How does the EM field affect a dead cell? Well, that's just it. The body never truly, or at least fully, dies. We can see by the synthetic portions of the body that the remaining meat suit is kept alive on a cellular level. This is more than likely to create a creature capable of actually walking and attacking. These synthetic portions afford the creature some damage protection. Seeing as their body does not really rely upon the movement of blood in a traditional sense, shooting a husk does not equal their end like it would a human. Instead, taking more shots than an average person. However, their main weakness lies in the fact that their bodies are thinner and frailer. Succumbing to close quarter shots, they seemingly fall apart, whereas a human would more than likely at least stay together. So, time to back up what I just said. Notice when you game in Saren that his organic body is done. Saren is gone, he is dead. Saren clearly takes out his own brain in the process if you talk him into it, or if you simply put enough lead into him, it will bring him down. However, after his synthetic alterations begin to take over, he is given a second life. Much of the same can be said about the husks. It seems, while the person is still alive, perhaps their brain provides some sort of resistance, but eventually their defense is eroded away after seeing what happened with Saren. In the husk case, the defense is never there to begin with, so they are quickly changed into what Saren is. So what happens? Quite a bit. We've covered the body, but the brain is where really the interesting part of the husk lies. As we know, the EM field degrades the brain of a person. With the presumed exposure from the spike and these waves, I can see certain portions of the brain being targeted, specifically the cerebrum and limbic system. Interestingly, EM waves can also generate neurons as well as destroy, which works perfectly. The cerebrum is more than likely degraded entirely, except for its most basic parts. This would erase memories and higher thoughts, producing quite literally a husk. With the cerebrum eroded and the intelligence of the creature decimated, the EM waves go to work on another portion of the brain, the limbic system. The limbic system is responsible for the creature's aggression. Emotion is complex, there are quite a few processes involved, but for the most part, the limbic system is going to be responsible. A logic limbic system equates to more aggression. It is more than likely that the husk have their limbic systems bolstered, leading to a completely savage creature incapable of reasoning or thinking. They are essentially the perfect game-ending machine. Attacking any creature they see on sight, they will have no memory of loved ones or friends, and would take them out in a heartbeat. With their brains completely altered, it is likely that the husk is simply operating on instinct and aggression. The lizard brain, which is the midbrain, pons, and medulla, would more than likely still be functioning to allow the creature to move, but the higher portions of the brain would either be absent or severely damaged. This brain damage is backed up by Matriarch Benezia when she states that even if she receives medical aid from Shepard and his team, she will never be the same again. The brain of an individual is completely destroyed in this process of indoctrination, and even prior to becoming a husk, is still somewhat of a husk. The spear through the chest simply solidifies the process and changes them into a shambling cannon fodder.
With people being converted and being used as pawns either in body, mind, and even soul, it would eventually leak to the public that these almost mechanical zombies were being reported all around, although to high public skepticism, especially with indoctrinated officials saying it's nothing more than fictitious propaganda. Collectors would be harvesting people left and right to add to their, well, collection, and eventually, once all the chips were in place, Sovereign would execute the Reaper's final phase of their harvest, activating the Citadel, unknown to us humans, but was actually one giant dormant mass relay that can bring in all Reapers from the deepest pocket of dark space, ushering in an unstoppable fleet of indestructible Reaper vessels to Citadel space, and within just a few hours, all colonized worlds and our homeworld Earth would be invaded. Roanoke and I went in depth about the beginning stages of a Reaper invasion, but when it comes to the Reapers themselves finally showing up, it's a no-brainer. The Mass Effect trilogy had to unite the entirety of nearly a dozen species with their psychokinetic powers, mechanical and technical skills, and more, and they barely came out to win and get on top, depending on your choices in Mass Effect 3. In Mass Effect 1, it took a coordinated effort of more refined technology to take out Sovereign. With what weapons we have at our disposal right now, and what may have developed while we did discover the Prothean technology, we would most likely just launch a nuclear strike that would barely even damage a Reaper, let alone hundreds of them. Our leaders would literally bow before their masters as they arrive, asking to be assimilated in any way possible to appease the Reaper overlords, causing even further panic in the streets and police and military personnel watching their leaders just bow down to this ungodly enemy. This dysfunction in the masses would ultimately be our downfall, as it was for the Protheans. We had been doomed to repeat their mistakes. The only way to even stand a chance against the Reapers is to unite with other species and coordinate an attack that could overwhelm the strongest threat known to even exist in the universe. Their sheer size, impervious material, destructive death rays, and expansive ground forces on top of their indoctrination would eliminate a large portion of humanity, no matter the planet, within weeks. Stragglers and counter-resistances would attempt to try and stop them any way they could. could, but within a few years, humanity would crumble and fade from existence. Anybody left would starve out. Falling in line with countless races before us, the humans would be a continued chapter after the Protheans in what would seem to be a cycle of extinction that would never end.
So that about wraps up this bleak look into the sheer terror the Reapers bring us if we started up their technology and thought we could conquer the cosmos. Did Zakaz or I miss any crucial information? How do you think the humans would fare in this scenario? Let us both know down in the comments. Don't forget to like, comment, and definitely subscribe to Roanoke Gaming and Wild Sludge Gaming for more lore-related content. And if you feel like supporting us further, we both have a Patreon to motivate us a bit more to continue our work.
Which special thanks to Patreon and YouTube Super Chat donators, Lovable Tester, Mario, Nato6141, Ricardo Ascension, Song of the Void, Irene, Twilight Duck, Castliv, Daniel Tapia, Exploding Burritos Experience, Shilarvi Turtlord, Deja Cheatham, Kimberly, Summer Denny, Stubbs the Zom, Super Amazing Hot Dog Batman, Taylor07, Synatics, The Silver Jedi, NinjaKirby935, The Lonely MV14, Taylor07, Raul Alvarado, Roanoke Gaming, Snow, Adrian Velasco, Christina Reese, Ghost Toast, Mindless Cheeseburger, Gage Drenzi, Drasolite, Synatics, Bianca Stevens, Jake's YouTube channel, Thomas Bailey, Cold Wolf, Uganda Knuckles, The Queen, and Slothic Goth. Thank you for your generous donations to Wow Such Gaming. Well, Roanoke, it's been a pleasure collaborating with you. Feel free to stop by again anytime if you feel like showing off those biological skills. And hey, maybe I can stop by your channel sometime and we can discuss some Left 4 Dead.
Absolutely. In fact, in the near future, I have a video I could use your expertise on concerning just that. After all, I hear you are something of an expert on Left 4 Dead.
Sounds like a plan. Well, until next time, I'm Zakaz, aka Wild Sludge Gaming.
And I'm Roanoke Gaming.
Thanks for watching. Check out Roanoke's channel and content. And don't forget to stay wow!